بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ما بعد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم تنزيله بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ورفعنا لك ذكرك صدق الله العلي العظيم. My dear respected, most honorable ulama, scholars, blessed inheritors of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my noble elders, beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, we begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by glorifying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for enabling us with this unique and wonderful opportunity to congregate in His house, to worship Him, to glorify Him, and to send salutations upon His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we pray that Allah Azza wa Jalla will continue to facilitate such wonderful opportunities for us in the future, inshaAllah.
Ameen, Ya Rab.
I have to first seek forgiveness from you. I haven't been feeling well the last couple of days, you can probably tell. So if you hear me sniffling or blowing my nose, please do excuse me. I seek forgiveness in advance for that. But khair, this is a gathering that remembers the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is a gathering of healing, without a shadow of a doubt. The kalam of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam, the praising of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is not only a means of drawing closer to him, but it's a means of cleansing your body and your soul. The ulama and the scholars of the past who would praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would utter statements like amdahu man athna al-ilahu bi wasfihi. Before praising him, they would say that how can I praise that individual whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised with his own attributes. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, two of his names are Ra'uf and Rahim. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gifts those two attributes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Other reciters and other praises of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that al-madhu wasilatun ila al-mahabbati wa ta'zim. That this praising that we do of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is a means of love and veneration, and that's the actual emphasis of such gatherings, and that's the result. That should be the ultimate result of such gatherings. That when we hear the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when we hear the praises of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not only do we increase in our love for him, not only do we increase in our veneration for him, but we also seek to emulate his beloved sunnah. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Say to them that if you truly love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow me. And what's the thamra? What's the fruit? What will you get if you love Allah and you follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? يُهْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, and He will forgive for you your sins. This is the ultimate reality of a Muslim. Our reality is that our lives are incomplete without the mention of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our chests expand with the mention of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. A munshid once said, بِذِكْرِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ يَنْشَرِهُ الصَّدْرُ. That is, it is only with the remembrance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger of Allah, that the chests expand and are able to receive some of that Muhammadan light. And this is, in essence, what we're here for today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the contributions of all of those individuals who have praised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those individuals who will praise him, and all of you sitting here today, who not only will seek to praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but to emulate him and to follow his sunnah. Let me give you a few examples of, you know, when we talk about praising the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and na'at or nasheed of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam, it's impossible to mention na'at and nasheed without mentioning the likes of Imam al-Busiri rahimahullah ta'ala. You probably heard his qasida, Al-Qawakib al-Durriya fi Madhi Khair al-Bariya. That's the actual name of the qasida, Burda, right? The Burda, which is 110 verses split over 10 chapters. You know, I've actually compiled a commentary of just the first chapter of the Qasida Burda. And I'm in the process of doing more. And you know, subhanAllah, having studied the Qasida, I've come to the conclusion that there are hundreds of commentaries. Ibn Ajiba, the great Moroccan scholar, Imam Al-Kharbouti, and many of them. Hundreds of scholars have attempted to commentate on what the Burda actually means. In it, you know, the very first verses, Mawla Yusalli isn't a verse of the Burda itself. Mawla Yusalli wa sallam da'iman abada. That chorus isn't actually a verse. In it, Imam Al-Busiri, in the very first chapter, he's talking about himself and his hal after having fallen in love with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he's talking about his own state, what's happened with him having fallen in love with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He starts by saying, أَمِنْ تَذَكُّرِ جِيرَانٍ بِذِي سَلَمٍ مَذَجْتَ دَمْعًا جَرَامٍ مُقْلَةٍ بِدَمِي أَمْ حَبَّتِ الرِّيْهُ مِنْ تِلْقَاءِ كَاذِمَةٍ أَوْ أَوْمَدَ الْبَرْقُ فِي الظُّلْمَاءِ مِنْ إِدَمِي. In this he's talking about places. He's saying, is it because of the remembrance of the neighbors of the Jiran, Dhu Salam? Dhu Salam was a place between Mecca and Medina, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would stop whenever he was undertaking that journey, and he would rest there. And Busiri had never been to Dhu Salam. He had never seen Dhu Salam. And he's talking about Dhu Salam because it's connected and attached to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He talks about Kadhima and the lightning of Idam. These are places and times associated with the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he's saying that because of them, everything that is associated with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of my love for the Prophet, those things have become beloved to me as well. You know, subhanAllah, in all of the commentaries of the Qasida that I've read, and I went through about 11 or 12 commentaries of the Qasida. Each and every one of them has mentioned the story of Layla and Majnun. There's some young brothers here. You know, you've heard of the stories of the Layla and Majnun. Layla and Majnun actually existed. Majnun is short for Majnun, which is madman. And that was a name given to a tabi'i. He was from the second generation after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His name was Qais. And he had fallen in love with this woman called Layla. And he had never seen Layla. And it's reported by Kharbouti in his sharh, in his commentary, that Majnun or Majnun couldn't function without the mention of Layla. Everything that was attached or affiliated with Layla became beloved to Majnun. So Majnun would walk through the streets where Layla would reside, and he would touch the walls, and he would kiss the dogs, the street dogs. And people would say, this is why we call you Majnun, right? You're crazy. You're a madman. Why are you doing this? He would say, you don't know. These walls are of significance to me, maybe not to you. These walls are connected to my Layla. This dog, this street dog, it walks through the streets of Layla. And everything that was attached or associated with Layla became beloved to him. And our love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by far transcends any love that you can have for any other human being. This is without a shadow of a doubt. Without a shadow of a doubt. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, none of you can claim true belief, true iman, until I become more beloved to you than your father, your child, and all of mankind. Anybody. That's our love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at Sayyidina Bilal. You know, in the Qasida, and this is a lesson not only for us as ones who listen to the praise of the Prophet, but also those who praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inference is the best way. Inference means that when you talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would allude to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam without directly mentioning that individual. Right? Like Busiri, he talks about his hal, having fallen in love with the Prophet, but he doesn't mention the Prophet by name. In fact, in those 110 verses, he only mentions the name Muhammad twice, and once he's referring to himself because his own name was Muhammad. Only once. He's referring to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by name. When we look through or read through the seerah of the Prophet, the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know what we'll notice? Never once did a companion look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or address the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam by saying, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad. No. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Nabi Allah, Ya Habib Allah, O Messenger of Allah, O Prophet of Allah, O Beloved of Allah. That's how they would refer to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And it's imperative that we too try to emulate them, these individuals, when we seek to praise the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. It's imperative that we understand that level of respect when praising the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. It really is key. It's impossible for us to attach ourselves to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam without that ta'zim, without that respect and veneration for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. I'm going to give you a few indications of, you know, when we talk about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, we're connected to him, right? Each and every one of us is connected to the Prophet. Whether we understand that connection or not, whether we appreciate that connection or not, irrespective of that, we're still connected to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. When we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, even that is connected to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, this is a very beautiful verse, I've mentioned it a few times before. In this verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to make a statement. He said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٍ. When my servant asks you about me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٍ, then I am near. In this verse, the statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to make, and pay attention to this, the statement, the message that Allah is trying to convey is inni qareeb, that I am near. But he could simply have stated, Ya ayyuhan nas, inni qareeb. O people, I am near. Or Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, inni qareeb. O you who believe, I am near. But that's not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. He said, Wa idha sa'alaka ibadi anni, fa inni qareeb. When my servant asks you, O Muhammad, about me, fa'inni kareeb, only then I am near. I.e. when my servant approaches me, having sought you, having gone through you, only then am I near to him, and only then will I answer his prayers. So our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is dependent upon our connection with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the strength of our connection with the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. Not only are we urged to seek through Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that all the previous prophets were told, this is in these are verses of the Quran, all the previous prophets were made to take an oath that if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come during their time, they would support him and they would believe in his message and they would support him in it. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us of. When Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, when he ate from the tree, this is a narration mentioned by Imam al-Hakim in his Mustadrak with a sound chain leading to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He states that when Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, he ate from the tree, he petitioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his divine forgiveness. And he petitioned Allah for his divine forgiveness by saying these words. He said, Oh my Lord, I am asking you to forgive me for the sake of Muhammad. Subhanallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questions him, says, Oh Adam, how do you know that I have a prophet, or I even have a creation whose name is Muhammad? And Adam alayhi salatu wasalam replied that when I looked towards the uppermost part, when I looked towards your throne, I saw written on its uppermost part, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And I realized that individual whose name is joined with your name, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That individual whose name is synonymous with your name, that truly is going to be the most beloved of people to you. And I'm asking you to forgive me for the sake of Muhammad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this particular narration, the reply that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave was, Ya Adam, ghafartu laka wa li ajlihi khalaqtuk. Oh Adam, I have forgiven you, and it is for his sake I created you to begin with. It is for his sake that I created you to begin with. This is quite amazing if we think of it. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's remembrance isn't only specific to this time. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرًا, we've raised for you your remembrance. His remembrance wasn't raised only by his ummah. It was raised even by those who came before him. And I'm going to give you some examples of that, insha'Allah ta'ala. The connection and the attachment of the creation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The entire code, you know Shaykh Muhammad ibn Alawi al-Maliki rahimahullah ta'ala, the great Makki scholar who passed away, he says something quite amazing. He says, Al-Kawnu li Muhammad. He says, the universe is for Muhammad. Everything is for the sake of Muhammad. All of the universe is connected to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just like a tree, it has roots, doesn't it? Right? And the whole universe is rooted in the remembrance of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is what he stated. And I'll give you a few examples of that. I mentioned this story, and there's some brothers here who might have heard it before. And this will interest you. Imam al-Qurtubi and other exegetes of the Quran, other mufassireen have mentioned this in their respective commentaries. Regarding the Jews of Medina, you know, there were tribes of Jews, the Banu Qaynuqa, the Banu Qurayza, who lived in Medina and resided in Medina even prior to the arrival of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that town. And now, how did they get there? How did the Jews come to this barren, desolate land, which was Yathrib at the time? And why did they choose to settle there? The story goes back about 150 years before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A dam burst in Yemen, and the king of Yemen, along with some of his subjects that included priests from among the Christians and rabbis from among the Jewish community, they left and they went towards Makkah al-Mukarramah. They ventured north. They came to this hustling, bustling town of Makkah, where they saw this house, the Kaaba. The Kaaba existed. And he saw people worshipping the Kaaba, doing tawaf, circumambulating the Kaaba. And he questioned his people. He said, what are they doing? He said, they're worshipping their idols. Some people are worshipping their idols, doing tawaf of them. Others who are on the deen of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, they're doing tawaf of the Kaaba and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, this is not good. He made the intention there and then that I'm going to destroy the Kaaba. As soon as he makes that intention, immediately he becomes ill, violently ill. It's reported he became so ill that bugs and insects were crawling out of his ears and his eyes and other orifices of his body. And the physicians were helpless. The physicians didn't understand what this ailment was, what this disease was. Nobody could help him. So when he left with the physicians, he said, look, he called the rabbis and the priests and he said, look, this is something otherworldly. Right? This disease and this illness that I have. Right? Tell me what's the, you know, how can I get over this? How can I become healthy once again? So they, the priests and the rabbis, questioned him. And I forgot to mention the king's name. King's name was Tubba al-Himyari. And he said, they asked Tubba, they said, Tubba, have you made the intention to do something wrong recently? Right. He said, I made the intention that I'm going to destroy that house which people do tawaf of. And the priest and the rabbi said, take that intention back and instead intend khair. Intend to do something good. So he immediately, before going to sleep that night, he says to himself, I'm not going to destroy the Kaaba. Not only am I not going to destroy it, I'm going to get a ghilaf, a covering, made from the finest silk in Yemen to place over the Kaaba, because at the time it was just bricks, there was no ghilaf, there was no covering over it. And then I'm going to create two doors, one door to enter, there was no doors to the Kaaba, one door to enter and another door to leave, and I'm going to create a lock and a key, and I'm going to give that key to one of the custodians there to take care of. As soon as he makes that intention, he goes to sleep. In the morning he wakes up and subhanAllah, he's cured. His illness, it's as if he was ill to begin with in the first place. So he realizes there's something special about this bait. There's something special about this house. So he was actually the first person who did actually get a ghilaf, a covering to place over, a kiswa, to place over the Kaaba. He created two doors, a lock and a key, and he gave the key to a custodian there. He done his own tawaf and he left and ventured further up north. They passed by beautiful gardens, beautiful greenery, arriving at this barren, desolate land. This town was called Yathrib that he arrived at. The rabbis who were with him, the Jews, they said to Tubba, they said, Tubba, we're going to settle here. You go back to Yemen, we're not going to go back with you, we're going to settle here. And Tubba said to them, that makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. We passed by green pastures, by beautiful gardens, and you're leaving them to settle at this barren, desolate desert land? What's wrong with you? Why do you want to stay here? What's so special about this place? And the rabbis said to Tubba, they said, this is the place where the last prophet, the prophet of the end of time, he's going to come and he's going to migrate, he's going to do hijrah, and he's going to come and reside here. And we want to meet him. So he decided, they decided to stay. Tubba, on the other hand, thinks to himself, well, you know what? Maybe I may not have, or I may not be alive by the time this prophet arrives. So is there something that I can do in order to connect myself with the last prophet? So what he decides to do is he builds a house in Mecca, in this town, in this Yathrib. He builds this house and he gives over the keys to that house to one of the residents of the city. And he says to him, this house belongs to you, is yours, is for your family, for your children and their children. Up until the arrival of the last messenger, when he comes and he migrates to this land, this house is no longer yours, you have to give the keys to him. Fast forward 150 years later, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, amid much fanfare, enters the city of Yathrib, now known as Al-Madinatul Munawwara, the illuminated city. Tala al-Badru alayna, people are singing in the streets, people are overjoyed at the arrival of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And everybody wants the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or wants to have the honor of hosting the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. Ya Rasulullah, please honor us by coming and staying at our house. Imagine having, you know, this wasn't a normal guest. This guest was the most noblest of guests, khayru khalqillah, the best of Allah's creation. And everybody wanted to have that honor. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who never said no to anyone, didn't want to upset anyone, he very diplomatically stated that a man is with his camel. And he said, the camel's been instructed. The camel has been instructed, and wherever the camel shall stop, that's where I'm going to stay. And whose house did the camel kneel down and sit down in front of? Young brothers. Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari is the descendant of that man who Tubba gave the keys to and said, this is your house, this is your home. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't stay or live in anybody else's house. He lived in his own house when he arrived in Madinatul Munawwara. The house was built for that purpose. This is how, you know, 150 years before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everything is associated and affiliated, the kaun, the universe is associated and attached to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This love and this attachment, this connection to him isn't only felt by human beings, it isn't only felt by you and I, or those in his time. Even inanimate objects felt this yearning and this attachment to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There's a famous story that you may have heard. And this is a hadith mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. I don't understand why there's so many individuals among our communities who haven't heard of this narration. Because this, it feels sometimes as if the message of this narration has been hidden from the public by certain strands of our society. In this hadith, in Sahih Bukhari, it's authentic, rigorously authenticated hadith. There's absolutely no doubt regarding the authenticity of this hadith. It concerns a jiza, a tree trunk. When the Sahaba, they built the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as pillars, to construct as pillars, they laid certain tree trunks there, just trunks. Which has been cut down, trees that have been cut down, and those trunks had been placed there. There was this one particular trunk that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would lean against when he would deliver his khutbah on a Friday. After a few months or a few weeks, the companions decided to construct a minbar, a platform, upon which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could stand and lean and sit in order to deliver his khutbah. The very first Friday that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ascended the minbar, ascended the pulpit, the companions report that they could hear a loud wailing sound, a crying sound coming from within the vicinity of the masjid. Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, and he reports that the sound of wailing and crying was so loud that people as far as the back of the masjid could hear the wails, could hear the sound. And that sound was coming from that tree trunk, which was now crying and yearning for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's reported by the companions that it continued to cry up until the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam descended from his minbar, and he went up to that tree trunk and he hugged it, subhanAllah. And then he turned to the companions and he said, لَوْ لَمْ أَحْتَدِنْهُ لَبَقِيَ هَكَذَا إِلَىٰ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. If I hadn't hugged it, by Allah, it would have remained like this, crying up until the day of judgment. So these inanimate objects that had no life in them were given life due to their attachment with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This tree trunk, that mount of Uhud, those of you who have been to Medina, you've seen the beautiful mountain of Uhud. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was once standing upon the mount of Uhud. He had with him Abu Bakr, he had with him Sayyidina Umar, he had with him Sayyidina Uthman, may Allah be pleased with all of them. And Uhud began to shake. It began to tremble as if there was an earthquake. And the companion reports that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Uskun Uhud." He said, "Be quiet, O Uhud." Adhunnuhu daraba bi rijli. And I think he struck it. I believe he struck it with his foot, as in he struck his foot upon the mountain, and he said, "Quiet me down. Do you not know that on top of you, standing on top of you, is a prophet, a siddiq, and two martyrs?" Immediately the mountain began to stop shaking, subservient to the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That tree trunk, this mountain, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib karramallahu wajha, he reports that kharajtu ma'a Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam liqada'i ba'di hajati fama mararna bi shajarin wala hajarin illa qal assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. He said, we went out with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to fulfill a need, and we did not pass by a single tree or a single stone except that it called out, it exclaimed, assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Inanimate objects connected and attached to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They felt this yearning. If inanimate objects that have no life can feel this potent yearning for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then I ask you, how can the hearts of the believers not yearn for the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam? How can we not yearn to be attached and associated with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The whole universe was made subservient to his command. How can we not fulfill his command? When the entire universe, it was made fard upon the universe to fulfill the command of the Prophet, how then can we disobey those commands of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? You know, you've heard of the famous story of the Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, the great magnificent journey of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Jerusalem, from Jerusalem to the seven heavens, meeting with his Lord, coming back with the gift of Salah. Right? There's a part of that story that perhaps you may not have heard, authenticated by Al-Bazzar and many others, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back and he told the Quraysh, and he told them about this magnificent journey that he had just undertaken, they thought, this is the ammo that we needed, right? Because we used to call him, na'udhu billah min dhalik, majnoon, crazy. We used to call him a madman, we used to call him a sorcerer, a magician. But we were never able to call him a liar. Never. Because we were the individuals who gave him the title of As-Sadiq wal-Ameen to begin with. People would laugh at us if we just turned around and said he's lying. Because Muhammad has never ever told a lie, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they thought to themselves that this is now the ammo that we needed. This is the ammunition we needed against the Prophet and his message. We're going to tell the people he's lying, he's clearly deceiving you. How can a man take such a long journey from Makkah to Jerusalem, then Jerusalem to the seven heavens, all in the space of one night? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they asked him for proof, do you know what he said? He said that on the way back he passed by a caravan, and he told them who was accompanying the caravan and what goods the caravan was laden with. And he told them that this caravan will be arriving in Makkatul Mukarrama before Wednesday, before sunset on Wednesday, on Yom Al-Arbi'a. And they said, okay, challenge accepted, that's fine. We'll wait until Wednesday, sunset. If the caravan arrives as you described, then you're truthful. And if it doesn't, then you're a liar. And we've got the ammunition that we need to turn people away from you. So they waited. On Wednesday, sunset is approaching. The caravan has not yet arrived. The Quraysh, the mushrikeen are jubilant, thinking this is it, we've got him exactly where we want him. The believers, who were few in number and quite weak at the time, their hearts are trembling, thinking, what if this caravan doesn't arrive? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to be humiliated. What these individuals, all of them didn't know is that they had a man among them who all it took for him was to raise his blessed hands. And when he raised his hands, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never turned down any of his du'as. Allah raised, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam raises his hands. He makes du'a and says, Ya Rab, don't let your deen, don't let your religion, don't let your prophet be humiliated today. By Allah, the historians report, and subhanAllah, they said that the sun was about to set, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped the sun from setting, kept it in his position up until the caravan arrived into that city. And as soon as the caravan arrived, only then did Allah allow the sun to set. The whole universe subservient to the command of the Prophet, sitting in his cradle, pointing at the moon. And wherever he points his finger, the moon moves in that direction. Subservient to the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the birth of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. So it's imperative that we understand, if all of the creation is attached, associated, yearns for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeks to emulate the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam, seeks closeness, qurba, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we too need to seek that. There's something drastically wrong with our state. There's something wrong with our hal if we don't yearn for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's imperative that when we yearn for him and we love him, we claim to love him. Loving Muhammad means living Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means living upon that which he has commanded you to do. So if there's anything that you can take away from this gathering and from gatherings that commemorate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is to abide by his blessed sunnah. Remember, you know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm going to end it here, inshallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an individual who had a pure tongue. Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik, who's reported in the hadith of Imam Bukhari as Khadimi Rasulullah, the servant of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that I spent 10 years in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَاحِشًا وَلَا مُتَفَحِّشًا وَلَا لَعَانًا وَلَا سَبَّابًا. That I spent 10 years in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Never was he abusive, never did he swear, never did he curse and use foul language. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, we swear in our daily speech. Something happens, this and that and that. Right? Using abusive language. This is not the sunnah of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never struck anybody, never hit anybody. How often do we do that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the best of people towards his family. How are we in terms of our relationship with our family? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was always truthful. He always told the truth. He was always honest. How honest are we in our dealings with the people? How truthful are we in our dealings with the people? It's imperative. You know, when you want to be inspired by the Prophet sallallahu, or when you want your children to be inspired by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you have to beautify the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to them. And how do you go about doing that? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left this material plane 1400 years ago. You go about doing that by immersing yourself within the character of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, by becoming perfect representatives. So when you tell your child, when you try to teach your child that the Prophet was always truthful and he never told a lie, and he turns around, he said, Abuji, you're lying all the time. Why do you say that? Why do you say that? What you yourself don't do? So children are naturally only going to be inspired by you when you yourself serve as an inspiration for them. And that's the most important thing that you have to take away from these gatherings, to emulate the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. When you hear his blessed praises, it isn't just temporal. It isn't just for a short period of time. You do your naras and then you leave. No, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed five times a day. You too pray five times a day. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would recite the Quran. You too recite the Quran as often as you possibly can. Otherwise, these gatherings are meaningless if they don't bring you back to the path of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you the tawfiq and the ability to act upon the teachings of the Quran, the noble sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I thank our honorable hosts and for inviting me here today. I thank you all for attending, being a part of this gathering, listening attentively, sitting here, and taking in that Muhammadan light, that illumination. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of the contributions of those who came before me and those who will come after me, and accept your contribution most of all for you sitting here and listening attentively. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khair.